Good morning. We are so glad you've chosen to join us in worship this morning, and we want to spend some time together really encouraging each other in our faith journeys and celebrating some of the gifts that have been given to us by the Lord. And it's a chance we have to find some encouragement from each other. And obviously, we're not meeting in the Diamond Event Center this morning, and so many things have been adjusted and changed in the past week, and we want to acknowledge that, and we're thankful for the decisions that are being made to protect people and move in a direction of health as much as we can. And at the same time, we also want to spend some time celebrating together. And we can do that, we can celebrate, because there are some things in the middle of all the changes that are going on, there are some things that never change. And we're mindful today, we're thankful today that the scripture has told us of itself, the prophet Isaiah, as he was given word from the Lord, even though the grass withers and the flowers fade, the word of our Lord stands forever. And we have that security in the word that God has given us to base our faith on. And at the very same time, the word is a living word. It became flesh and made its dwelling among us. And we understand that that word is living today in Christ. And the scripture tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
And he is an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. And we have that confidence as we go through the challenges that we face in this life. So we want to encourage each other by looking into his word and also by singing together. And we have some guests here to lead us in singing. And it's Chaplain Q and his daughter Lydia. And we want to begin by singing together, "All the Way My Savior Leads Me." Now you can join in singing, or you can do like I do and hum along, listen to the words. But we hope this is a time of encouragement for you.
Good morning, Fresh Wind. We hope this finds you well, wherever it is that you might be. And again, the good thing is that we can come before his presence at any time. And so he promised us his presence where two or more are gathered in his name. And I think, does that count online?
That's right.
I think it does. But we can hold fast to his promises, that his presence is promised to us as we come before him in worship. So let's begin together. We need the sentiments of this hymn every day of our lives, and may we ask him to be our savior and our guide and our leader, and may we also trust that his eye is on the sparrow, and it most certainly is on us, and may it also be on people that are making decisions in these days. And so we come before him with reverence and with praise and with worship. All the way my savior leads me. All the way my savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread, gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter, and my soul gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see. Gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see.
Thank you very much, you guys. And what a great song to begin with here this morning. And you know, after a week like we've had this past week, so many things happen, and life continues to go on. And with all the activities, one of the things that happened at the Western Home Communities was we lost one of our residents on early Tuesday morning, and his name was Joe Wilson. And we ended up celebrating his life at a memorial on Friday. And it was interesting to listen to the testimony of his wife, Eileen, as she shared about their life together in over 50 years, and how God led them through over eight cities. And and the work that they did, but they ended up here in Cedar Falls, Iowa, and ministering as a professor at UNI, and they worked together and actually hosted and led the Special Olympics in the Unidome for many years, and their impact was great, and it was fun to celebrate their lives and together and celebrate Joe's life. But the interesting thing that happened for me during that ceremony was Eileen had picked a text of scripture that's a common text to be picked for memorial service. But at the same time, as I studied it and prepared for the memorial service, the text started to speak to me about our current situation in the culture. And I want to bring that to you today as a message from God's word. When we think about following Christ, there's such encouragement in his words. And if we look at his words and let them soak into our heart, they can have an effect on us, and we can put our confidence in them, and that can change the way we live. And the scripture says we're just passing through this life. We're aliens and strangers here. And think about Joe and Eileen living in 8 different cities. But now, as we celebrated Joe's life, we celebrated the fact that he has gone home now for good. And Jesus was comforting his followers around some uncertainty in their times and around this issue of death. And obviously there could be a lot of fear in our culture now as this virus would be attacking different people, and at the same time some were losing. And the scripture says many can be held captive through the fear of death. And God wants to set us free from that fear. And Jesus was giving some encouragement to his disciples at this time around the issue of death. And what he said to them was this. He said, first of all, do not let your hearts be troubled. What a great word for today, right from our Creator. What he's saying in that first phrase is really we have a choice of what we do with our hearts. And when God gives us an instruction, it's helpful to think about the tendency we generally have. I think he gives us instruction because he knows when things are going awry or things are a little rattled in our lives, we have a tendency to get worked up and troubled and anxious about things. And Jesus knows that. And so he's reminding us that that's a choice. And when my wife and I talk about loving each other as a married couple, we talk about the fact that what we think about makes a difference, and our mind steers our heart towards each other. So we encourage each other to think about those things we appreciate about each other, not those things that maybe sometimes annoy us about each other. And if we spend more time thinking about the things we appreciate about each other, that helps our hearts be open to one another. And Jesus is saying the same thing happens in our whole life. Whatever we think about directs our heart. And if we think about things that make us anxious and worried and these kind of things all the time, our hearts will be troubled. But he's saying, and the scripture encourages us, is take captive every thought to the obedience of Christ. And the Creator says this to us, we don't have to let our hearts be troubled. And then he moves into what we could do. And he says to us, put your trust in God. And also in me, Jesus said. Now this word trust is a word that describes us putting our confidence in something outside of ourselves. It's finding rest in something outside of ourselves. And that's what God is, in Christ is saying here to his followers. He's saying, in the middle of the chaos of the world, you don't have to let your hearts be troubled. You can find your rest, your confidence in me, in the Creator. And Jesus also said, also in himself. And the two of them actually sit on the throne together right now, running all things. This is no surprise to them, the virus. They're not wringing their hands, wondering what to do. They know their people. They know their sheep. They call them by name. We're in their hands. And he's saying this to his followers. In the middle of him facing death and the persecution they're going to experience, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, Jesus said. Trust also in me. And then he went on to paint a picture for him. And before I describe the exact words and look at the words Jesus said, it's helpful to understand the culture, the backdrop that Jesus is saying these words. He is using an illustration from the way family operated in the ancient Near East, When a family would start a home together, a husband and wife would build a house, they would often buy a little extra land so that they could expand the house as their family expanded, and they were called insulas. And should a married couple have a son, they would raise that son in their home, and then when the time came for that son to be of age and go find a wife, they were more arranged. The marriages were more arranged and families knew each other. And if there was a good match, the son might approach another family who had a daughter. And he would ask that family, especially that father, for the daughter's hand in marriage. And should that be granted to him and then the daughter would agree, they wouldn't schedule a wedding at that time. The son would go home to his house and he would talk to his father about adding on to their home and preparing a place where he could live with his new wife. And then they could start their family together. And then the son and his father would start to build a place for their new home. And however long that took, they would get it ready. And then once the space was ready, the son would go back to the family and say the room is ready, and they would again confirm the marriage, and then they would send out invitations to the wedding celebration, and then they'd have their celebration, and then of course the new couple would move into their home together. Jesus understood this about the culture, and he is describing now comfort to his followers about what's going to happen after he is crucified, then resurrected, and ascends to heaven. And he's saying to them, in the middle of all the challenges you're going to face, don't let your hearts be troubled and don't be afraid. And then he says this, and it's just this imagery of a preparation for a wedding. And it's really it's a tender love story that Jesus is using here. A story of a passionate groom who's preparing a space for his bride, whom he loves. And he's not going to forget about his bride while his bride is waiting. He's preparing for him. And when the time is right, he's going to come to receive his bride to himself. And so Jesus said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. And then he says this, in my Father's house, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. When Jesus ascended to heaven, he said this, you know, this is what he was going to do. I'm going there to prepare a place for you, as a groom would for his loving bride. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And then he said, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back to take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. One of the great comforts we have as believers walking in this world, I mean, if you know Christ, there is this assurance given us in his word that once we're done with this journey here, just as Joe Wilson did this week, we're on our way home to the place prepared for us. And we have that hope firm and secure in our hearts. Mm-hmm. And that can relieve for us. You know, I like what Billy Graham said. Maybe the passageway from this life into the next makes us nervous. But when Jesus was going to the heaven after, he said, if you knew where I was going, you'd be happy for me. There is a better day awaiting all of us that know the Lord. And we can live with confidence in that. And though this virus may take lives, if it takes the lives of people who know Christ, they literally go from being aliens and strangers in a world that's filled with pain and hurt and heartache into a home that Jesus described as paradise that is better than we can comprehend, the scripture says. And so we want to live with that hope in our hearts at the same time, being kind and compassionate with each other in the struggles that we face. But we shouldn't let fear overcome us, even the fear of death. As the scripture said, that holds many people captive. So we want to be wise. We want to be smart in the decisions that we're making at this time. But we don't want to let it steal our joy, steal our hope, steal our assurance, our confidence in God. Matter of fact, the scripture says God has not given us a spirit of timidity or fear, but one of power and love and self-discipline and a sound mind. The just shall live by faith. With faith we please God. So even if we're isolated in the quietness of a room because of things that are going on here, we can have this confidence in God and rest in Him and find assurance in Him. And we want to, you know, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. And all the news that we're hearing and everything else, they're not telling us much about this. But this gives us comfort for our souls, an anchor there. The Word of God will never change. The hope that it brings to us is always a living hope that we can operate in, and find encouragement in. And so I want to read it to you again. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you, a loving groom preparing a place for his bride. If I go to prepare a place for you, none of us knows the time of when he'll come to take us to be with him. But he wants us to be there with him in eternity. And then he said, you know the place to where I'm going. And Thomas said, how do I know? How do we know where you'd go? And Jesus said to him, and it's one of his more controversial statements, and it's been debated, but people have died for this belief over the centuries here. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. The way to hope, the way to peace, the way to an assurance and a confidence for eternity, it's really not in a path, it's not in a formula, it's in a person. And that is this person of Jesus. He is the way. And I would just encourage you today, maybe there's someone listening who's never opened their heart to the great gift of Jesus. I mean, he came into the world, not to condemn the world, but to save the world. And the scripture says he came with a loving invitation. And his words of invitation, you know, that echo down through history are like this. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Rest for your souls. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble of heart. He loves us like a groom preparing a place for his bride. So Jesus is working in that way now, preparing a place for us for all eternity. And in this time here, he's encouraged us to trust in him, to trust the Lord. Keep moving with faith and confidence in him. And we hope this is an encouraging word for you today. And we hope you find some strength from just this text of scripture. We're going to sing again together. I'm going to say a prayer, and then we're going to sing together another song that is a prayer, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. And so let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity to look into your word today, and thank you for each person that's listening here. We ask that you would continue to encourage us by the presence of your Spirit in our hearts, our minds, our souls. Remind us of these truths that you've laid out for us in Scripture. In the middle of an ever-changing world, we can count on your word, your promises to us. And you have encouraged us in your word, not to let our hearts be troubled, but to put our confidence, our faith in you. You've told us in your word, you've given us not a spirit of timidity or one of fear, but one of power, love, and self-discipline, a sound mind. Your Spirit wants to quicken in us a faith in you, a confidence in you, a trust in you. Think of the psalmist now, Lord, who said, when I am afraid, I will put my trust in you. Perhaps today, Lord, someone's listening, you're inviting them put their confidence, their trust in you. Set aside their worries, their fears, their anxieties, and rest in you. Lord, we all need help in doing this. So help us with this, Lord. Take our hand and continue to lead us. And as we continue to sing now, Lord, help this be a prayer from our hearts. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
you, Tim. For those that know and trust and put their hope in the Lord, what a home he is preparing. And we invite all of us that might be listening to this, that this would be our prayer, that we would invite precious Lord to take our hand and that he's going to lead us.
Today, and really, as we remind ourselves of these things that the Lord has taught us in his word, we also want to be a reminder to others. And as we have opportunity, we want to encourage faith in people. Without faith, we can't please God, and somehow God responds to our faith. And so we want to encourage that faith in one another, that confidence in God, so we can keep moving forward with an assurance in him. And as we do that, we want to be a light and a salt to those around us. And so I want to encourage all of you who are listening in the Western home communities to, let God be the lifter of your head. Don't let your joy be stolen during this time. And at the same time, be one who helps sort of spread not the coronavirus, but sort of a virus of faith. And if we encourage each other prayerfully in faith before God, then we can experience the best outcome of what we're dealing with now. And so I want to pray to that end for our community now and for our country and for our world. And then we're going to end singing the song, Because He Lives. And it's a sort of more of a little rousing song that we can sing together in faith. And hopefully that'll be an encouragement. So let's pray together, shall we? Father, we do come to you again and thank you for the great community in which we live here in the Cedar Valley. We thank you for the country that we live in and the many freedoms that we've enjoyed. And then we thank you for the beautiful creation of the world that you've put us in. We understand that it's stained by pain and sickness and hurt and heartache and even disease and virus like we're experiencing now. And as we walk through this world with those challenges, we need your help. And so as we are binding together in prayer here right now, we ask that you would be with our leaders and guide them in the decisions that they're making. Help them be attentive to the information they get and help us be wise. Give them wisdom and help them seek your wisdom in the decisions they're making. And then in our community right here, we ask for your continued direction and help as we make decisions. And we ask for your protection from this virus and the other things that are a challenging part of our world. We ask that you be near those who are suffering and need your comfort and encouragement and the compassion of your spirit at this time. And Father, in the middle of all that, we do ask that your spirit would strengthen us and renew us in our inner being to continue to walk with courage and faith and hope, because we have that deep understanding in our hearts that you're still alive, you're still on the throne, and you can still be trusted no matter what comes. We thank you for this, Father. We pray this in the great name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's end this morning with this great reminder that because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. And if you're able to dance up a jig, that'd be perfectly fine. But this is a good toe tapper. And if you know it, please, let's worship and let's sing along together. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river. I'll find life's fine, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Amen. Praise the Lord. You guys stay right there. Yeah, just look right in there. Thanks for joining us in worship today. And, you know, who knows? We may be here again next week.
I'd have to get used to this.
Yeah, and hopefully we'll keep getting, you know, more comfortable doing this. But thanks for joining us today. And as we go today, let's remember the Lord goes with us. He goes before us to lead us and guide us. He's given us his word as a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. He goes behind us to uphold us through the challenge of any trial. And he has promised to do that. He's an ever-present help in our time of need. And then he's promised to walk beside us, even within us, by the power of his Spirit for those who believe. And we hope you have a confidence in him and open your heart to him. Let his Spirit come in and encourage and strengthen you as your friend. Thanks for joining us and have a great rest of your Sunday.
Blessings, dear friends. Blessings.
Thank you, guys.